हम लाए हैं तूफानों से कश्ती निकाल के, इस देश को रखना मेरे बच्चों संभाल के। तेणु ओडिया कवितार जो दीर्घ परंपरा रही से माने केमती पुणी आम हाथ धरिकी से परंपरा भितर को आमको आम निजक से दर्पण से देखा। तेणु मुझे ये गुरुमा उपस्थित अच्छा गुरुजी उपस्थित अच्छा समस्त को भी स्वागत कर जो तालिकाटी मो हाथ अच्छी से प्रथम कविता पढ़वे सुचित्रा महाराणा से बोधे शोभन स्कूल सप्तम श्रेणी छात्री सुचित्रा महाराणा।
यही नववर्ष उपलक्षे मोर भाई भणी मान हार्दिक अभिनंदन और गुरुजन मान प्रणाम। मोर कवितार शीर्षक हूँ पीबा नाई मीठा विष जमा। मु कोणार्क शोभन शिक्षाश्रम छात्री सुचित्रा और सप्तम श्रेणी। 2015 मसीहा गला चली केते भलो मंद स्मृति नेइछि आदरी केते दुख रोग शोक जंत्रणाता मध्ये हिसाब के पारिबता करी एही पर 2016 आसिला ता मध्ये केते भलो मंद स्मृति से नेइ जीवो आमे किंतु नेबारे शपथ सजाडीबा निज जीवन को सजाडीबा निज जीवन को जेउ पदे रहिबो महत्व। जन्म हेले मृत्यु सुनिश्चित मृत्यु हेले जन्म निश्चिंत तेणु आस संस्कार बरिबा पुनर्जन्म होइबो उन्नत पुनर्जन्म होइबो उन्नत भल चिंता भाषा कम सब करिजिबा ए जीवन हेउ भल कर्म रे शेष ए जीवन हेउ भल कर्म रे शेष समय जाउछि चली वर्ष मास तारीख जाय बदले आमे किंतु बदलिबा ए नववर्ष लोभ राग ईर्षा हिंसा छाड़ी देबा बरि नेबा साधुता निष्ठा स्नेह दक्षमा।
मोर कवितार शीर्षक जण जण आमे भल मनीष हेबा मुक्ति आमे होई अछि सिना शांति नाही शांति नाही काही लांच चोरी हिंसा बढ़ी अच्छी शांति कहीं मिली हे भाई लांच बिना किसी कम करहब ना यही प्रतिजोगित सरबे पगल गरीब मरीज सीना मद पी अनेक खेलती हणमरा कटा खेल भल लोक पेट पुई भी पुरे ना पुओ झी भी नपारती पाठ पढ़ी घर तार ना कहीं रहे भड़ा घरे गुंडा उपद्रवे शोपे ना लाछित तो हुए तार माँ झी बोहू निरापद मणु ना कहीं सी जीवा को से डरुची हिंसा गुंडा मनुष्य आस आम शपथ नेबा आस शपथ नेबा आत्मशुद्धि मंत्र को बरिबा सब मनुष्यर शांति सुख पाई जणे जणे आम भल मनीष होगा जणे जणे आम भल मनीष होगा।
कवितार शीर्षक नव संवत्सर अपेक्षा करिछि मु अर्घ्य थाली धरी अपेक्षा करिछि मु अर्घ्य थाली धरी कल्पनार अगणित आशा भरी कल्पनार अगणित आशा भरी दूर हेब मनीष को मनीषर शोषण देखुछि मु वर्तमान भवे भरे कसण पहाड़ कांदुछि धरणी कांदुछि सबु वर्ष आस सबु वर्ष जाओ आस किछि आशा देखाई जा आस किछि स्मृति नेई आसीबा पूर्वरु तुमको ही प्रश्न आसीबा पूर्वरु तुमको ही प्रश्न तुमे कौन कुह बंचिब तारा हसीब एधरा देकी पारिब जन्म आगामी बर्षरे देकी पारिब जन्म आगामी बर्षरे जणे बुद्ध गांधी ओ मेहर एही प्रश्नर केही त देइन उत्तर एही प्रश्नर केही त देइन उत्तर किंतु देव तुमे मो प्रश्नर उत्तर स्वागत भरा नव संवत्सर 2016
मारे तुम प्रश्न बड़ दारुण प्रकृतरे यार उत्तर दबापाई माने आमे दोषी ए उत्तर आम दे पार्न तेणु बेले बेले अनेक समय पिला मानक क्षमा मागिए जे से माने जो स्वप्न देखुं सेमती संसार टिके सजाड़ा आम संभव हलु ना ये भारत बर्षर स्वाधीनता पर आम जो पीढ़ी रही चु से तुम पाखे मुझे क्षमा मगुची एवं तुम्हें जो स्वप्न देखु से निजे निजे से स्वप्न को सफल कर आशीर्वाद शुभकामना भी करुच्ची नुआ बर्ष श्री कृष्ण रंजन पात्र को एथसहित डाकुची षष्ठ श्रेणी छात्र कविता पढ़े
शीर्षक हेउछि बर्षर प्रारंभ नववर्ष बर्षर प्रारंभ शुभाशीष स्तंभ अटै नववर्ष आनंद उल्लास संगे धरी आसी आम मने दिए हरस दर्पण सदृश बार्ता दिय तुम्हे शांति मैत्रीर सत्वाणी तुम्हरी गारिमा शुभेच्छार सीमा केतक पारिब बखाणी सुख परे दुख दुख परे सुख एई तो दुनिया रीति सुख दुख को आदरी बंचिब खुशी खुशी रहिब से नीति। ଧରମା ପରି ତ ଛୋଟ ପିଲା ମୁଁ ହିଁ ଜାଣିନି ଅଧିକ କିଛି, ଯେତିକି ଶୁଣିଛି ଯେତିକି ଜାଣିଛି ମୋ ମନୁ ତାହା ଲେଖିଛି। ନୁହେଁ ମୁଁ ଲେଖକ, ନୁହେଁ ମୁଁ ଗାଳ୍ପିକ, ନୁହେଁ ମୁଁ କବିର ଗୀତି, କେମିତି ଲେଖିବି କେମିତି ବର୍ଣ୍ଣିବି ନବବର୍ଷର ରାଜକୀର୍ତ୍ତି। କାପାଇଁ ହରସ କାପାଇଁ ନିରସ ଅଟଇ ନବବରଷ, ହେଲେ ମୋ ପାଇଁ ନବବରଷ ତ ଅମୂଲ୍ୟ ଗୀତିର ରସ। କରୁଛି ପ୍ରଣାମ ହୃଦୟ କରି ଆନ ନବବର୍ଷ ହେ ତୁମକୁ, କି ଗୀତ ଗାଇବି କି ଲେଖା ଲେଖିବି ସ୍ୱାଗତ କରି ହେ ତୁମକୁ। ଠାକୁରଙ୍କ ପାଶେ ଏତିକି ମଳି ସେନ୍ତି ମୈତ୍ରୀର ବାଣୀ, ସମସ୍ତଙ୍କ ହୃଦେ ଭରି ଦିଅ ନୂଆ ବରଷ, ହାତରେ ହାତକୁ ମିଶାଇ ଯେପରି ରହିଥିବୁ ଚିର ହରସ।
ଖୁବ ସୁନ୍ଦର, ଆପଣମାନେ ଲକ୍ଷ୍ୟ କଲେ ସିଏ ଲେଖିଛନ୍ତି ଯେ ଦର୍ପଣ ସଦୃଶ ବାର୍ତ୍ତାଟିଏ ଦିଅ, ଆଉ ଧରମା ପରି ସେ ଛୋଟ ପିଲାଟି, ଏଇ ଦୁଇଟା ଯେଉଁ ଏକ୍ସପ୍ରେସନ୍ କେତେ ଚମତ୍କାର ହେଇଛି। ଦର୍ପଣ ଇଏ ଯେଉଁ ପିଲାମାନେ ଯେଉଁ ଦର୍ପଣ, ୟାଙ୍କ ପଛଆଡ଼େ ପାରଦ ଛାଡ଼ି ଯାଇନି, ପାରଦ ଭର୍ତ୍ତି ହେଇକି ଅଛି, ଏତେ ସ୍ୱଚ୍ଛ ଦର୍ପଣ ଯେ ଆମେ ସେଠି ନିଜ ମୁହଁ ଦେଖିବାକୁ ଲାଜ ମାଡ଼ିବୁ। ତେଣୁ ଏଇ ଦର୍ପଣ ଝଟ ଝଟ ଝଟକୁ ଥାଉ, ଏଇ ଶୁଭେଚ୍ଛା ସହ ଅସିତ କୁମାର ସାହୁ ସପ୍ତମ ଶ୍ରେଣୀର ମୁଁ ଡାକିବି ତାଙ୍କୁ।
ମୋର କବିତାର ଶୀର୍ଷକ ହେଉଛି ଦୀପଟିଏ କର ମୋତେ ପ୍ରଭୁ, ଦୀପଟିଏ ମୋତେ କର, ଦୀପଟିଏ ମୋତେ କର ପ୍ରଭୁ, ଦୀପଟିଏ ମୋତେ କର। ଅନ୍ଧକାରରେ ଏବେ ମୁଁ ଆଲୋକ, ଅନ୍ଧକାରରେ ଏବେ ମୁଁ ଆଲୋକ, ଅନ୍ଧାର କରିବି ଦୂର, ଅନ୍ଧାର କରିବି ଦୂର, ଚାରିଆଡ଼େ ଆଜି ଅନ୍ଧାର, ଚାରିଆଡ଼େ ଆଜି ଅନ୍ଧାର, ଚାରିଆଡ଼େ ଶୁଭେ ହାହାକାର, ଚାରିଆଡ଼େ ଶୁଭେ ହାହାକାର, ଦୀପଟିଏ ହୋଇ ଜଳିବି ମୁଁ, ଦୀପଟିଏ ହୋଇ ଜଳିବି ମୁଁ, ବେଦନା ମନରୁ କରି ଦୂର, ବେଦନା ମନରୁ କରି ଦୂର, ଜଳିବାରେ ଦୁଃଖ କରିବିନି, ଜଳିବାରେ ଦୁଃଖ କରିବିନି, ହସି ଆସି ମୁଁ ହିଁ ଜଳିଯିବି, ହସି ଆସି ମୁଁ ହିଁ ଜଳିଯିବି, ପ୍ରତିମନ ପ୍ରାଣ ହସାଇବି, ପ୍ରତିମନ ପ୍ରାଣ ହସାଇବି, ଶାନ୍ତି ପ୍ରାଣେ ଭରିଦେବି, ଶାନ୍ତି ପ୍ରାଣେ ଭରିଦେବି, ପର ଉପକାର ହେବ ବ୍ରତ ମୋର, ପର ଉପକାର ହେବ ବ୍ରତ ମୋର, ଦୀପଟିଏ ମୋତେ କର ପ୍ରଭୁ, ଦୀପଟିଏ ମୋତେ କର।
ତେଣୁ ଅନ୍ଧକାରରେ ଆଲୋକ ଖୋଜୁଥିଲେ ଅସିତ, କେତେ ଚମତ୍କାର କଥା ଯେ କେହି ଜଣେ କହିଥିଲେ ଅନ୍ଧାର ବୋଲି କିଛି ନାହିଁ, ଅନ୍ଧାରଟା ହେଉଛି କେବଳ ଆଲୋକର ଅନୁପସ୍ଥିତି। ଯେତେବେଳେ ଆଲୋକ ଉପସ୍ଥିତ ହେଇଯାଏ ସେ ଛୋଟିଆ ଦୀପଟିଏ ହେଉ ପଛକେ ଅନ୍ଧକାର କୁଆଡ଼େ ଚାଲିଯାଏ, କିନ୍ତୁ ସେ ଦୀପଟିଏ ହେବାକୁ ବେଳେବେଳେ ନିଜକୁ ନିଜେ ଜାଳିବାକୁ ପଡ଼େ। ଦେଖିଲେନି ଛୁଆମାନେ ଜଳିବା ପାଇଁ ପ୍ରସ୍ତୁତ, ତେଣୁ ଅନ୍ଧାର ଆଉ ଆଦୌ ରହିବ ନାହିଁ। ସେଥିପାଇଁ ମୁଁ ବର୍ତ୍ତମାନ ତାପରେ ଟିକେ ଡାକିବା ସେଇ ଶୋଭନୀୟ ଶିକ୍ଷାଶ୍ରମର ସୌମ୍ୟରଞ୍ଜନ ପାଢ଼ୀଙ୍କୁ ଡାକିବି ସପ୍ତମ ଶ୍ରେଣୀର, ସେ ତାଙ୍କ କବିତା ପଢ଼ିବେ। ସୌମ୍ୟରଞ୍ଜନ ପାଢ଼ୀ।
ମୋର କବିତାର ଶୀର୍ଷକ ହେଉଛି ନୂଆବର୍ଷ ଆସିଛି ରେ ନୂଆବର୍ଷ ଆସିଛି, ନୂଆବର୍ଷ ଆସିଛି ରେ ନୂଆବର୍ଷ ଆସିଛି, କେତେ ହସ ଉଲ୍ଲାସକୁ ସାଥିରେ ସେ ଆଣିଛି, ଏହି ନୂଆ ବରଷରେ ମଉଜ କରିବା, କେହି କାହା ମନରେ ଦୁଃଖ ତ ନଦେବା, ଏହି ନୂଆ ବରଷ ସୁଖମୟ ହେଉ, ଶାନ୍ତି ଆଉ ସମୃଦ୍ଧିରେ ଭରପୁର ରହୁ, ଏହି ଦିନଟିକୁ ଆମେ ମନେ ରଖିଥିବା, ଏହାର ସ୍ମୃତିକୁ ଆମେ କେବେ ନ ଭୁଲିବା, ଏହି ଦିନ ଠାରୁ ବଡ଼ ନାହିଁ କେଉଁ ଦିନ, ଏହି ଦିନ ଜିଣିନିଏ ସମସ୍ତଙ୍କ ମନ, ଏହି ଦିନ ଠାରୁ ଆମେ ଈର୍ଷା ହିଂସା ଛାଡ଼ି ଅହିଂସା ଆଉ ସତ୍ୟତା ନେବା ସବୁ ପରି, ସାଧୁତା ନିଷ୍ଠାକୁ ଆମେ ଆପଣେଇ ନେବା, ଅସାଧୁତାକୁ ଯେ ଆମେ ଦୂର କରିଦେବା, କେବେ ହେଲେ ଏ ଦିନରେ ଦୁଃଖ ନ କରିବା, ହସ ଉଲ୍ଲାସରେ ଆମେ ଏହାକୁ ପାଳିବା, ସମସ୍ତଙ୍କୁ ଏ ଦିନରେ ଭଲ ବାଟେ ନେବା, ତାଙ୍କୁ କେବେ ମନ୍ଦ ବାଟେ ଛାଡ଼ିଣ ନ ଯିବା, ଏହି ଦିନଟି ଯେ ଅମୃତମୟ ହେଉ, ଏହା କେବେ କାହାକୁ ଯେ ଦୁଃଖ ନ ଦେଉ, ଗୁରୁଜନ ମାନଙ୍କଠୁ ଆଶିଷ ପାଇବା, ସଂକଳ୍ପ ନେଇ ଭଲ ମଣିଷ ଯେ ହେବା, ଏହି ଦିନଟିରେ ଆମେ ସଂକଳ୍ପ କରିବା, କେବେ ହେଲେ କାହା ମନେ ଦୁଃଖ ଯେ ନ ଦେବା, ନୂଆ ବର୍ଷ ଆସିଛି ରେ ନୂଆ ବର୍ଷ ଆସିଛି, କେତେ ଖୁସି ସୁଖକୁ ସେ ସାଥିରେ ଆଣିଛି।
ବହୁତ ସୁନ୍ଦର ସୌମ୍ୟରଞ୍ଜନ, ସବୁଟି ଏ ସବୁଗୁଡାକ କବିତାରେ କେତେ ଆଶା କେତେ ସ୍ୱପ୍ନ, ଏଠି ନିରାଶାର ଟିକେ ବି କିଛି କଥା ନାହିଁ। ଆମେ ବଡ଼ମାନେ ଏପର୍ଯ୍ୟନ୍ତ ଯେଉଁ କବିତା ପଢ଼ୁଥିଲୁ ଆମ ଭିତରେ ଦୁଃଖ ବ୍ୟଥା ହତାଶା ଏସବୁକୁ ରୂପ ଦେଉଥିଲୁ ସିନା, କିନ୍ତୁ ଏ ଆଶାରେ ଅଫୁରନ୍ତ ସ୍ୱର ସେ ଯେମିତି ଆମର ସେ ସବୁ ସ୍ୱରକୁ ମିଥ୍ୟା କରିଦେଉଛି, ଏବଂ ସେ ସବୁ ସ୍ୱର ମିଥ୍ୟା ହେଇଯାଉ ଏଇଟା ଆମ ପାଇଁ କେତେ ଖୁସିର କଥା, ଆମେ ଥାଉ ନଥାଉ। ତେଣୁ ଏ ଆଶାର ସ୍ୱର ସତରେ ଅଭିଭୂତ କରୁଛି। ଏଠି ଚମତ୍କାର କବିତା ଅଛି ମୋ ହାତରେ, ଦୁଇଟି ଇଂରାଜୀ କବିତା, ଇଟ୍ସ ଏ ଗର୍ଲ ଚାଇଲ୍ଡ ଆଣ୍ଡ ଲାଇଫ୍ ହି ନେଭର୍ ଲିଭ୍ଡ। ମୁଁ ସେ କବିତା ଦୁଇଟି ଉପରେ ଏତେ ବସରେ ଟିକେ ଆଖି ବି ପକେଇ ଦେଇଛି, ରୋହିଣୀ ସ୍ମିତା ସାଇ ଇଣ୍ଟରନ୍ୟାସନାଲ ସ୍କୁଲ କ୍ଲାସ୍ ଟେନ୍ର ସେ ଛାତ୍ରୀ ସେ ପଢ଼ିବେ। ଆପଣମାନେ ଶୁଣିଲେ ଜାଣିପାରିବେ ଯେ କେତେ ଏତେ କମ୍ ବୟସରେ କେତେ ପରିପକ୍ୱ କବିତା ସେ ଲେଖିପାରିଛନ୍ତି ଏବଂ କେତେ ବର୍ଣ୍ଣିଂ ପ୍ରୋବ୍ଲେମ୍ ଯେଉଁଟା ସୋସାଇଟିର ତା ଉପରେ ସେ ଆଲୋକପାତ କରିପାରିଛନ୍ତି। ରୋହିଣୀ
ଇଫ୍ ହି ନେଭର ଲିଭଡ୍ ପୁଟିଙ୍ଗ ଦ ବ୍ଲାଙ୍କେଟ୍ସ କଭରିଙ୍ଗ ହିଜ୍ ଫେସ୍ ଇଟ୍ ୱାଜ୍ ଟାଇମ୍ ଟୁ ଡ୍ରିମ୍ ଆଣ୍ଡ ରେସ୍ ଦ ଲାଇଟ୍ସ ଟର୍ଣ୍ଣଡ ଅଫ୍ ଆଣ୍ଡ ସାଇଲେନ୍ସ ଟୁକ୍ ଓଭର ଇଟ୍ ୱାଜ୍ ଟାଇମ୍ ଫର୍ ହିଜ୍ ସୋଲ୍ ଟୁ ହୋଭର ଇନ୍ ଦ କ୍ଲାସ୍ ରୁମ୍ ହି ସାଟ୍ ଡାଉନ୍ ସିଇଙ୍ଗ ନୋ ୱାନ୍ ଦେର୍ ହି ଫ୍ରାଉଣ୍ଡ ହି ୱକ୍ଡ ଓଭର ଟୁ ୱେର୍ ହିଜ୍ ଟାଇମ୍ ଟେବଲ୍ ୱାଜ୍ ପୁଟ୍ ଅଣ୍ଡରଷ୍ଟାଣ୍ଡିଙ୍ଗ ନଟ୍ ଅ ବେଟ୍ ଜଷ୍ଟ ଦେର୍ ହି ଷ୍ଟୁଡ୍ ହି ରାନ୍ ଥ୍ରୁ ଦ କରିଡୋର୍ ଜଷ୍ଟ ଲାଇକ୍ ଅ କ୍ରେଜି ଲାବ୍ରାଡୋର୍ ହି ଥଟ୍ ହି ୱାଜ୍ ଲଷ୍ଟ ହିଜ୍ ଆଇଜ୍ ୱେର୍ ମଏଷ୍ଟ ଦେନ୍ କଟ୍ ହିମ୍ ହିଜ୍ ଟିଚର୍ ୱାଟ୍ ଆର୍ ୟୁ ଡୁଇଙ୍ଗ ଲିଟିଲ୍ କ୍ରିଏଚର୍ ହି ଷ୍ଟୁଡ୍ ଦ ଦମ୍ ଷ୍ଟ୍ରକ୍ ନଟ୍ ବିଙ୍ଗ ଏବଲ୍ ଟୁ ସ୍ପିକ୍ ଅ ୱର୍ଡ The teacher understood his worries, took him to the field to end his queries. The little creature saw his friends, his smile extended till the ends. He ran like crazy people did, his tears went and hid. He played till the bell rang, until then with joy he sang. Coming to real life, still a little bit paralyzed, only if his dream came true, it could be the life he never lived. My second poem is It's a Girl Child. It's a girl child, they said, and just strangled her to death. That's how short her life was, being a girl was the cause. Only if she would have been he, spared his life, what her life would be. Said she could not get education, the kitchen was her only destination. She gets ready to forget her parents' house and adopts the parents of her spouse. Supported the parents physically, mentally and emotionally, still got tortured wholeheartedly. A country where goddesses are worshipped more than gods, how hypocritical never occurred them once. It's a girl child and just strangled her to death. Thank you. I'd like to thank the organizers for giving me this opportunity to present my poem. Thank you.
Organizers also got the opportunity to listen to your beautiful poems. ଥ୍ୟାଙ୍କ ୟୁ ଅଲସୋ।
ମୋର କବିତାର ଶୀର୍ଷକ ଭଲ ଗୁଣ ଶିଖି ଆଗକୁ ଚାଲୁଛି। ଭଲ ଗୁଣ ଶିଖିବି ମୁଁ ଭଲ ଗୁଣ ଶିଖିବି ଯାହାଠାରେ ଯାହା ଅଛି ଯାହାଠାରେ ଯାହା ଅଛି। ପ୍ରତିଦିନ ସୂର୍ଯ୍ୟଙ୍କୁ ଦେଖୁଛି ପ୍ରତିଦିନ ସୂର୍ଯ୍ୟଙ୍କୁ ଦେଖୁଛି। କେତେ ସେ ଆଲୋକ ଢାଳୁଛନ୍ତି କେତେ ସେ ଆଲୋକ ଢାଳୁଛନ୍ତି। ମହୁମାଛି ଦେଖୁଅଛି ମହୁମାଛି ଦେଖୁଅଛି। ଏ ଫୁଲରୁ ସେ ଫୁଲକୁ ବୁଲୁଛି ଏ ଫୁଲରୁ ସେ ଫୁଲକୁ ବୁଲୁଛି। ମହୁ ମହୁ ସଂଗ୍ରହ କରି ଫେଣରେ ସାଇତି ରଖୁଛି ମହୁ ସଂଗ୍ରହ କରି ଫେଣରେ ସାଇତି ରଖିଛି। ବୃକ୍ଷ ଦେଖୁଅଛି ମୁଇଁ ବୃକ୍ଷ ଦେଖୁଅଛି ବୃକ୍ଷ ଦେଖୁଅଛି। ଫୁଲ ଫଳ ପତ୍ରରେ ସେବା କରୁଅଛି ଫୁଲ ଫଳ ପତ୍ରରେ ସେବା କରୁଅଛି। ବାୟୁ ବହୁଅଛି ପୁଣି ବାୟୁ ବହୁଅଛି ବାୟୁ ବହୁଅଛି। ମଣିଷ ଜୀବ ଜଗତ ତା ପାଇଁ ଚାଲିଛି ମଣିଷ ଜୀବ ଜଗତ ତା ପାଇଁ ଚାଲିଛି। ଜଳ ମୁଁ ଦେଖୁଛି ପୁଣି ଜଳ ମୁଁ ଦେଖୁଛି ଜଳ ମୁଁ ଦେଖୁଛି। ସବୁଠି ପ୍ରାଣ ପ୍ରାଣ ସବୁଠି ପ୍ରାଣ ପ୍ରାଣ ଶୋଷ ମେଣ୍ଟାଉଛି ସବୁଠି ପ୍ରାଣ ପ୍ରାଣ ଶୋଷ ମେଣ୍ଟାଉଛି। କେତେ କେତେ ଭଲ ଗୁଣ କେତେ କେତେ ଭଲ ଗୁଣ ଅନୁଭବ କରୁଛି ମୁଁ କେତେ କେତେ ଭଲ ଗୁଣ ଅନୁଭବ କରୁଛି ମୁଁ। ସେହି ଭଲ ଗୁଣ ଶିଖି ସେହି ଭଲ ଗୁଣ ଶିଖି ଆଗକୁ ଚାଲୁଛି ମୁଁ ଆଗକୁ ଚାଲୁଛି ଆଗକୁ ଚାଲୁଛି।
ଏବେ ମୁଁ ଡାକିବି ଲିଟୁ ସ୍ୱାଇଁ ସପ୍ତମ ଶ୍ରେଣୀର ଶୋଭନୀୟ ଶିକ୍ଷାଶ୍ରମର ଲିଟୁ ସ୍ୱାଇଁଙ୍କୁ ତାଙ୍କ କବିତା।
ମୋ କବିତାର ଶୀର୍ଷକ ହେଉଛି ହେବି ମୁଁ ସୂର୍ଯ୍ୟ ହେବି ହେବି ମୁଁ ସୂର୍ଯ୍ୟ ହେବି ହେବି ମୁଁ ସୂର୍ଯ୍ୟ ହେବି। ସବୁରି କଲ୍ୟାଣ ଚିନ୍ତି ସୁକର୍ମ କରିଯିବି କାହା ମନେ ଦେବି ନାହିଁ ଦୁଃଖ କାହା ମନେ ଦେବି ନାହିଁ ଦୁଃଖ। ଦୁଃଖ ଥିଲେ ଭରିବି ମୁଁ ସୁଖ ଦୁଃଖ ଥିଲେ ଭରିବି ମୁଁ ସୁଖ। ଦିନ ଦୁଃଖୀ ନିରାଶ୍ରୟ ସେବା ମୁଁ କରିବି ହେବି ମୁଁ ସୂର୍ଯ୍ୟ ହେବି ହେବି ମୁଁ ସୂର୍ଯ୍ୟ ହେବି। କ୍ଳାନ୍ତ ମୁଁ ହେବି ନାହିଁ ନେବି ନାହିଁ ବିଶ୍ରାମ କର୍ମ ହେବ ମୋ ଜୀବନ କର୍ମ ହେବ ମୋର ପ୍ରାଣ। ଶାନ୍ତି ଦେବି ପ୍ରତି ପ୍ରାଣ ଅଶାନ୍ତି ମୁଁ ହରିନେବି ହେବି ମୁଁ ସୂର୍ଯ୍ୟ ହେବି ମୁଁ ହେବି ମୁଁ ସୂର୍ଯ୍ୟ ହେବି। ସ୍ନେହ ଦୟ କ୍ଷମା ଏହି ବ୍ରତ ନେବି ମୁଁ ବରି ସ୍ନେହ ଦୟ କ୍ଷମା ଏହି ବ୍ରତ ନେବି ମୁଁ ବରି। ହିଂସା ଘୃଣା ରୁଷ ଦେବି ମୁଁ ତଡ଼ି ହିଂସା ଘୃଣା ରୁଷ ଦେବି ମୁଁ ତଡ଼ି। ପର ଉପକାର ମୁଁ ଜୀବନ ଦେବି ହେବି ମୁଁ ସୂର୍ଯ୍ୟ ହେବି ହେବି ମୁଁ ସୂର୍ଯ୍ୟ ହେବି।
ଅଞ୍ଚଳର ଛୁଆ ସୂର୍ଯ୍ୟ ତ ହବ ହିଁ ହବ ସୂର୍ଯ୍ୟ ମନ୍ଦିର ଏଠି। ଏବେ ଡାକିବା ଆମେ ଚିନ୍ମୟ ମଲ୍ଲ ଷଷ୍ଠ ଶ୍ରେଣୀର ছাত্র শোভনীয় শিক্ষাশ্রম কবিতা পড়বে।
মোর কবিতার শীর্ষক প্রকৃতি মাতা। সেই সুন্দর প্রকৃতি মাতা কোলরে জন্মিছি মুহি, সেই সুন্দর প্রকৃতি মাতা কোলরে জন্মিছি মুহি, তারি কোল মার ঝুলনা পণত কানি, তারি সবুজ গছর ফল, তারি সবুজ গছর ফল, তারি রঙ বিরঙ্গ ফুলর বাসনা মহকাই দিয়ে সারা জগতকু, তারি সেই নীল গগন, তারি থন্ডা শীতল পবন মনকু করি দিয়ে সুখময়, তারি স্নেহ সেই স্নেহ ভরি দিয়ে জীবনের সুখর সুয়, তারি সেই স্নেহ ভরি দিয়ে জীবনের সুখর সুয়, তারি কর্মর তারি কর্মকু ভরিছি মো দেহরে, তারি সেবাকু করিছি জীবনের শেষ কর্ম, তারি সেবাকু করিছি জীবনের শেষ কর্ম।
যদি চিন্ময় মানে সমস্তে প্রকৃতি মাতাকু রক্ষা করিবাকু তার সেবা করিবাকু সংকল্পবদ্ধ হয়ে এবে আমি যে গতকালি গোটে আলোচনা করুতিলে যে আসন্তা বর্ষ নেচর এনভায়রনমেন্ট তাকু কেমতি রক্ষণাবেক্ষণ করা যাব সে সম্পর্কে আমি রকিবা চন্দ্রভাগা পোয়েট্রি ফেস্টিভাল কু এত আরম্ভ হয়ে গলানি পিলামানক কষ্টরে সে প্রক্রিয়া। পরবর্তী কবি হচ্ছেন আমার বিশ্বজিৎ মহাপাত্র, সে বি সপ্তম শ্রেণীর ছাত্র শোভনীয় শিক্ষাশ্রম।
মোর কবিতার শীর্ষক হচ্ছে সর্বদেবী মো আনন্দ, পড়িছি অনেক জীবন স্বামী বিবেকানন্দ, বুদ্ধ গান্ধী মহামনীষী শ্রীমা শ্রী অরবিন্দ, বিবেকানন্দঙ্ক আদর্শ ত্যাগ দয়া ক্ষমা, মো জীবন পরমব্রত ভুলিবিনি মু জমা, রামকৃষ্ণ থিলে সে আদরণীয় শিষ্য, পিতৃমাতৃ গুরু ভক্তির বিষ রখিগলে যশ, কর্মযোগী ধর্মযোগী সে স্বামী বিবেকানন্দ, তাঁক পরি নিশ্চয় হই মু সর্বদেবী মো আনন্দ, তাঁক পরি হই মু নিশ্চয় সর্বদেবী আনন্দ।
He is a wordsmith. His words are beautifully arranged and arranged in such a way that if you read the final poem, you can taste the honey that comes just like bees make a honeycomb and then they produce the honey. It's exactly like that. That's what I feel. Words don't come easily to people, but here is a man standing beside me who I have always respected, loved and admired for his work. It's my pleasure today to release this new book called Aerotex.
Beautifully produced.
Is like frosted glass. I'm happy, cocooned in my embryo. Nothing has happened. No, everything has happened. No, yet I'm getting carried away by the toasted air of the new season. Just a moment, I'll interrupt here. You see how beautifully he projects his views. He states, he makes a statement. That means he says something and he doesn't say something. That is the beauty of poetry, the ambivalence, the yin and the yang of poetry, the black and the white of poetry. They go together. You know, it's not like a poetry is not like a sadhu's dictates. It takes in the whole man, the part of which is good, the part of which is evil, not evil, the part of which is not so good. And that makes up a poem in its entire beauty. Now the second stanza. My heart strings conduct the tenor and part of a song I no longer have control over. Light as air, the inflected phrases waft in my imagined new home with you, alone, together, and all alone, smiling, kissing, kissing, and kissing. You are my song. Thank you.
So, yesterday my flight was delayed by 4 hours. And I believe a lot of other people were also stuck the day before for 3-4 hours. So that's why I could only reach here in the evening. So this would have happened yesterday. But I'm so glad it's happening today because I love children. I teach children and I'm completely overwhelmed by the quality of your work. So thank you so much for reading to us. I think Orissa has a great future. For really, I mean it because ami bangla boli amar oriya mane besh bhalo bhabe mane jani 60-70% of the poem I could, without even explanation, I could get. So I think the children here, we have to clap for them. Really, they're the future of real treat, a real privilege, and I think the organizers have thought through this very, very well. I was saying earlier that the reason that I came without even thinking, the moment I heard Chandrabhag and then a double treat that Jayantuda would be here, it was easy. My relationship with Jayantuda goes back at least 30 odd years. I thought I was young, but now age is catching up. And he just says, well, next to me, you can't beat me, of course. I was only a teenager when I had read his 3-4 books. And one of the books that had this lasting impression was called Relationships. A poem, and one poem, in an the whole poem was took an entire book space, a book-length poem. And at the time, I used to read this magazine, a newspaper called The Telegraph, which comes out of Kolkata. And Telegraph had a Sunday magazine called The Telegraph Magazine. Kushwant Singh used to be the fiction editor, and Jayanta Mohapatra was the poetry editor. On the in the magazine every week, there would be a small strip of coupon. You fill it up, write your address, phone number, of course. Very, very few of us had even landlines. And you put a stamp, and you send the poem out. The poem, on the poem, you don't write your name. You write your name on the little slip of paper and just put a number on the. Jayantuda picked up my poem. My first significant publication was Jayantuda. He didn't know me. He didn't know my name. He was reading this person's poem without the name, like he did for many other poets, and published me when I was in my teens. I was completely shocked, and since then, I was like Jayantuda, studying to be a physicist. I'm a science background, and I was going to be an architect. And what am I doing now? I'm a full-time poet. And thank you so much. My entire family was completely shocked. Chele hoy ingriji porbe, bas hoyche. You know, when the karani giri korari. So That goes back over 30 years. And since then, of course, we have met many times. I've been to his house. There's a poem I wrote for Jayantuda and Runudi, late wife. He used to have this wonderfully elongated, slanting mango tree in his house, which was almost parallel to the ground. So often you could sit there as a bench. And The Whiteness of Bones was one of your books and poems. And to me, the bark, because they used to sit on it, the bark was like a shiny bone. Beautiful tree that still remains etched in my memory. So this is his session, really. I'm being squeezed into this session. So what I propose to do is we have an hour. I will take up maybe 15, 20 minutes, and then we'll give him as much time as you want. Is I am going to be very naughty, by which I mean last evening we, many of us sitting around the dinner table, had a significantly charged discussion. I'm happy to announce, even though he is not announcing it and I'm taking this liberty, I'm happy to announce that Chandrabhag magazine in its third new avatar will start coming out from this year. He's given us the blessing. It was one of the finest literary magazines in the country until it stopped after 29 issues. So the 30th issue, it's a good number because it's a multiple of three, the triad, the Trimurti, will be released hopefully by the end of the year. Jayantuda will continue being its editor. Rabindra Swain, another very fine young Indian poet who I admire also. Of course, admiration for both of them is a lot. He will continue being the managing editor. My insistence is because those two were doing it, they should still continue doing it. And there will be about 5 or 6 of us who were around the table. We will be the slaves, happy foot soldiers to get it going. So I'm very happy, Jayantada, that you've said yes, even though you haven't quite said yes. But Jayantada can say something about it.
No, it's I shouldn't have stopped the journal that Sudeep Sen is talking about. It's very difficult to stop a journal, you know, when it's running for some time and you are involved with it. It's like killing your own child. And that's a very painful situation. Nobody realizes it. And when you've taken so much time, so much energy, so much love over it. So, I don't know, Sudeep says, and all of us here are agreeable that I should continue it. But I don't know, I am not so young in my years that I can say tomorrow I can do it, I can climb up Konark. I can't do those things anymore. But thank you for your support, thank you for your concern, thank you for your attention that you have given Chandramaga. That is something I will never forget. And I'm grateful to all of you for asking me to revive this magazine, which I love from the depths of my heart. Now, before we go over to some poetry, I'll just continue something that ended up the last session. Pilavane tamane bahut sapna dekhila bahut kavita lekhila bhalo lagila au apanna madam bi kahile je kete kata hei jaichi se kata sabu tumko bhalo lagu nai boli tumi ichha karucha duniya ta ko badlaibaku apanna madam kahile दुनियाटाको केमती बदलैब दुनियाटाको बदलैको पडले तमको किछि जिनस मागिबाकु पडियो तमे बापा माको जा मागो गोटे चॉकलेट मागिले बापाको त मागो कि गोटे मोबाइल मागिबो जदि छोटिया मोबाइल बापा माको मागिबो मोबाइल मागिले त देबे समझि तमे सरकारनको मागो तमे लेख तमे रहिता दरकार मो पाखरे जो मस्तिटी अछि ତା ପିଲାଙ୍କୁ ବି ଖାଇବାକୁ ମିଳୁ ସେ କଥା କୁହ ସେ କଥା କହିଲେ ତମେ ମାଗିଲା ପରେ ଲାଗିବ ତମେ କିଛି କରିପାରିବ ଆଉ ଖାଲି କବିତା ଲେଖିଲେ କାଗଜରେ କିଛି ଲାଭ ହେବନି ତମେ ଲେଖ ଲେଖ ମ୍ୟାଗାଜିନ୍ ପତ୍ରିକାମାନଙ୍କରେ ଲେଖ ମନ୍ତ୍ରୀମାନଙ୍କୁ କୁହ କ'ଣ ହେଲା ତମେ ଛୋଟ ପିଲାଗୁଡ଼ା କାହିଁ କହିବନି ଯେ ମୋତେ ଏଇଟା ଦିଅ ମୋର ଭାଇମାନଙ୍କୁ ଏଇଟା ଦିଅ ମୋର ଭଉଣୀମାନଙ୍କୁ ଏଇଟା ଦିଅ ଖାଲି ତମେ ଏକା ଭଲ ପିନ୍ଧିକିରି ବୁଲିବ ସେଇଟା ଠିକ ନାହିଁ ଭାବୁଛି ମୁଁ କିଛି ଖରାପ କଥା କହିନି ଠିକ ଅଛି ଥ୍ୟାଙ୍କ ୟୁ ଆଣ୍ଡ ନାଉ ମୁଁ ଆଉ ଗୋଟେ କଥାରୁ ଆରମ୍ଭ କରିବି ଟିକେ କାଲି ଦୁର୍ଗା ପ୍ରସାଦ ଅଛନ୍ତି ଦୁର୍ଗା କାଲି ଗୋଟେ ଗପ କହି ଆରମ୍ଭ କଲେ ମୁଁ ବି ଗୋଟେ ଛୋଟିଆ ଗପ କହିକିରି ମୋ କଥାଟି ଆରମ୍ଭ କରିବି ଓଡ଼ିଆରେ କହିବି ସୁଦୀପ ପ୍ଲିଜ୍ ଏକ୍ସକ୍ୟୁଜ୍ ମି ଆଇ ନୋ ୟୁ କ୍ୟାନ୍ ଅଣ୍ଡରଷ୍ଟାଣ୍ଡ ଆଟ୍ଲିଷ୍ଟ ହଁ 60% ଅଫ୍ ହ୍ୱାଟ୍ ଆଇ ଆମ୍ ସେଇଙ୍ଗ୍ ଅନେକ ଦିନ ତଳେ ଗୋଟେ ରାଜା ଥିଲେ ବିରାଟ ରାଜା ବହୁତ ତାଙ୍କର ସମ୍ପତ୍ତି ବହୁତ ଘର ଦ୍ୱାର ରାଜା ଯେମିତି ଥାନ୍ତି ସବୁ ଆମର ତ ଓଡ଼ିଶାର ବହୁତ ମହାରାଜା ସବୁ ଥିଲେ ଯେତେବେଳେ ତମମାନେ ଜନ୍ମ ହେଇନଥିଲ ଅନେକ ବର୍ଷ ତଳେ ମୁଁ ଯେତେବେଳେ ଥିଲି ଛୋଟ ପିଲା ହେଇକି ତମ ଭଳିଆ ଥିଲି ସେତେବେଳେ ରାଜାମାନେ ସବୁ ଓଡ଼ିଶାରେ ରାଜତ୍ୱ କରୁଥିଲେ ଛୋଟ 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 ରାଜା ଏ ନରସିଂହପୁର ଆଠଗଡ଼ ବଡ଼ମ୍ବା ଏମିତି ହୁମା ଚାରିଆଡ଼େ ଏମିତି ଚାରିଆଡ଼େ ରାଜା ସବୁ ଥିଲେ ଏମିତି ଗୋଟେ ବଡ଼ ରାଜା ଥିଲେ। ଥରେ ରାଜା ଭଲ ରାଜାଟା ଥିଲେ, ମୋ ମତରେ ସେ ବହୁତ ଭଲ ରାଜା ଥିଲା। କ'ଣ କଲେ, ଏକା ଏକା କିଛି କରନ୍ତିନି, ସମସ୍ତଙ୍କ ଡକେଇକିରି ତାଙ୍କ ପାଖରେ ବସାନ୍ତି, ବସେଇକିରି ତାଙ୍କୁ ସବୁ ପଚାରନ୍ତି କେଉଁଟା କଲେ ଭଲ। ଥରେ ସେମିତି ବହୁତ ଲୋକଙ୍କୁ ଡାକିକିରି ତାଙ୍କ ପାଖରେ ବସିଲେ ଆଉ ସେମାନଙ୍କୁ ପଚାରିଲେ। ବହୁତ ଲୋକ ଥିଲେ, ସବୁ ସ୍କୁଲ ପିଲାଙ୍କଠୁ ଆରମ୍ଭ କରି ବୁଢ଼ା ବୁଢ଼ୀ, କବି, ଶିକ୍ଷକ ଶିକ୍ଷୟିତ୍ରୀ ଭର୍ତ୍ତି ହେଇଥିଲେ। ଆଉ ତାଙ୍କୁ ପଚାରିଲେ, ଆଚ୍ଛା କହିଲ ଦେଖି, କବି ଗୋଟେ ପାଖରୁ ଯିଏ କବିତା ଲେଖେ ସେ ତ କବି, କବି ଗୋଟେ ପାଖରୁ ତମେ କ'ଣ ଚାହ? ସେଠୁ ଜଣେ କହିଲା, ଉଠିକିରି କଣରେ ଛିଡ଼ା ହେଇଥିଲା ଜଣେ ଭଦ୍ରଲୋକ ଛିଡ଼ା ହେଇକିରି କହିଲା, ମୋର କବି ପାଖରୁ ଏମିତି କଥା ସବୁ ଶୁଣିବାକୁ ଚାହେଁ, ଯେମିତି ଯତି ପଢ଼ୁଥିବ ଭଲ କିରି ସେ ଗୀତ ଗାଇ ହେଲା ଭଳିଆ ଗାଇ ହେଉଥିବ, ସେମିତିକା ମୋର କବିତା ଦରକାର, ମୋର ଆଉ କିଛି ଦରକାର ନାହିଁ। ମାନେ ଯେମିତି ମୁଁ ଗାଇପାରିବି ସେ ଗୀତ ଗୁଡ଼ାକ ମୋତେ ଖୁସି ଲାଗିବ, ମୋର ସେମିତିକା ଦରକାର ଜଣେ କହିଲା। ଆଉ ଜଣେ ଅନ୍ୟ ପଟେ ବସିଥିଲା, ସେ ଉଠିକିରି କହିଲା ଯେ ମୋର ଭଲ ପାଇବା ଉପରେ, ପ୍ରେମ ଉପରେ ମୋର କବିତା ଦରକାର, ମୁଁ ତତେ ଭଲ ପାଇବା ଉପରେ, ପ୍ରେମ ଉପରେ, ପ୍ରେମ ଉପରେ ଯେତେ କଥା ହବ ମୋତେ ଭଲ, ମୋତେ ଖୁସି ମିଳିବ, ମୋତେ ଆନନ୍ଦ ମିଳିବ। ରାଜା ସବୁ ଶୁଣୁଥାନ୍ତି ଚୁପ୍ ହେଇକିରି। ସେଠୁ ସିଧା ଆଉ ଦୁଇ ତିନିଟା ଆହୁରି କଥା କାଟି ଦେଉଛି, ସିଧା ଯାଉଛି ଶେଷକୁ। ସ୍କୁଲ ପିଲାମାନେ ବସିଥିଲେ, ସ୍କୁଲ ପିଲାମାନେକୁ ପଚାରିଲେ ତମର କ'ଣ ଦରକାର, ତମେ ଗୋଟେ କବି ପାଖରୁ କ'ଣ ଚାହୁଁଛ? ଗୋଟେ ସ୍କୁଲ ପିଲା ଉଠି ଚାହିଁଲା, ଉଠି କହିଲା, ମୋର ଗୋଟେ ଦିନ ଛୁଟି ଦରକାର, ମୋର ଆଉ କିଛି ଦରକାର ନାହିଁ, ମୋ ଛୁଟିଟା ହେଲା ମୋତେ ବଢ଼ିଆ ହେବ, ମୁଁ ଯାଇକିରି ଖେଳିବି। ଏମିତି ଅନେକ ଜଣ ଅନେକ କଥା କହିଲେ, ମୁଁ ସେ କଥାକୁ ଯାଉନି, ବହୁତ କଥା କହିହେବ, କିଏ କ'ଣ ଚାହେଁ ବୋଲି। ଶେଷରେ ଗୋଟେ କଣରେ ଗୋଟେ ପାତିଲି ବେମାରୀ ବୁଢ଼ୀଟି ବସିଥିଲା କଣରେ ସଭା ପଛରେ। ତାକୁ ରାଜା ପଚାରିଲେ, ହେଲୋ ମା, ତୋର କ'ଣ ଦରକାର, ତୁ ଗୋଟେ କବି ପାଖରୁ କ'ଣ ଚାହୁଁ? ସେ କହିଲା, ମହାରାଜା ମୋର କବି ପାଖରୁ ରକ୍ତ ଟିକେ ଚାହେଁ, ଆଉ କିଛି ଚାହେଁନି, ରକ୍ତଟା ଚାହେଁ କହିଲା ବୁଢ଼ୀ। ସେଠି ରାଜା ସବୁ ସମସ୍ତଙ୍କ କଥା ଶୁଣିଲେ ଆଉ ପୁରସ୍କାର ସେ ବୁଢ଼ୀଟାକୁ ଦେଲେ, ଯେ ଆମେ କ'ଣ ଚାହୁଁ କବି ପାଖରୁ, ଆମେ ତା ରକ୍ତ ଚାହୁଁ, ରକ୍ତ ମାନଙ୍କ ସତରେ ତା ରକ୍ତ ଚାହୁଁନୁ, ତାର ଏଇ ହୃଦୟର ହୃଦୟଟା ଚାହୁଁ, ତା ହୃଦୟ ଭିତରେ ଯାହା ଅଛି ଯେଉଁ ବିବେକଟା ଅଛି ସେଇଠାରେ ଯେମିତି କିଛି ମିଥ୍ୟା ନ ରହିବ, ସେଇଟା ଯେମିତି ଗୋଟେ ଗୋଟେ କ'ଣ କହିବି, ଗୋଟେ ଗୋଟେ ପ୍ୟୋରିଟି, ଗୋଟେ ଗୋଟେ ହଁ ସେଇଟା ସେ ଚାହେଁ, ସେଇଥିରେ ରକ୍ତ ବାହାରେ, ସେଇ ତାର ଯନ୍ତ୍ରଣାରୁ, ସେଇ ଘାରୁ, ସେ ଅନ୍ୟମାନଙ୍କ ପାଇଁ ଘାରୁ ତାର କବିତାଟା ବାହାରେ। ଆଉ ତମେ ଯଦି ଅନ୍ୟମାନଙ୍କ ଘା ଦେଖିପାରିବ ନାହିଁ, ତମେ କବିତା ଲେଖିପାରିବ ନାହିଁ, ସେଇ ଯୋଗୁଁ ତମେ ମନେ ରଖ। ପିଲାମାନଙ୍କ ପାଇଁ ମୁଁ ଏଇଟା ଗପଟି କହିଲି ଯେ ଘାଟାକୁ ତମେ ଭୁଲିଯିବ ନାହିଁ, ତମେ ଦେଖିବ ଗୋଟେ, ତମେ ଆସିଲା ବେଳେ ଦେଖିବ ବାଟରେ ଦେଖିବ କୁକୁରଟା ଏମିତି ଶୋଇକି ପଡ଼ିଛି, ତା ଆଖିରୁ ପାଣି ବାହାରୁଛି, ଗୋଟେ ବଳଦ ଗାଡ଼ିଟା ଯାଉଛି, ବଳଦ ଆଖିରୁ ଟୋପା ଟୋପା ପାଣି ଗଡ଼ୁଛି, ତମେ ଦେଖିବ ତମକୁ କିଛି କଷ୍ଟ ଲାଗିବ, ଭୁଲିକି ଚାଲିଯିବ ତମେ ସେତିକି ଟିକେ। ଖାଲି ମୁଁ କହୁନି କିଛି କରିବ ବୋଲି, କିନ୍ତୁ ଟିକେ ମନରେ ଟିକେ ଦୁଃଖଟା ଅନୁଭବ କଲେ ଭଲ ଲାଗେ, କାରଣ ଦୁଃଖରୁ ହିଁ ସବୁ ଜିନିଷର ଆମର ଆରମ୍ଭ, କବିତାର ବି ଆରମ୍ଭ। ସେତିକି କହି ମୁଁ ମୋ କବିତାକୁ ଯିବି। ବିଗିନ୍ ୱିଥ୍ ଆଇ ଡୋଣ୍ଟ ହାଭ୍ ଏନି, ଆଇ ଫର୍ଗଟ୍ ଟୁ ଗେଟ୍ ମାଇ ଓଡ଼ିଆ ପୋଏମ୍ସ, ବଟ୍ ଆଇ ବିଗିନ୍ ୱିଥ୍ ଆଇ ଡୋଣ୍ଟ ନୋ, ଦେର୍ ୱାଜ୍ ଜଷ୍ଟ ୱାନ୍ କପି ଅଫ୍ ଏ ପୋଏମ୍, ଇଟ୍ସ ନଟ୍ ଏ ଗୁଡ୍ ପୋଏମ୍, ବଟ୍ ଆଇ ଲାଇକ୍ ଟୁ ରିଡ୍ ଇଟ୍ ଟୁ ୟୁ। ଦିସ୍ ହ୍ୟାପେନ୍ ଇନ୍ ଓଡ଼ିଶା ଆଗେନ୍। some years back, and still we are waiting for justice to be done. I don't know about all these things. When I read the poem, I know you'll get the context of it. And the title of the poem is Udhar Dei Paribu Ki Mate To Murtyu Ko Lakhi. Udhar Dei Paribu Ki Mate To Murtyu Ko Lakhi. Eka Eka Na Sabu Vale Thilu Tu Eka Na Sabu Vale Eka Thilu Tu Lakhi. Savita, tu bi, sabu bale eka eka. Tiki tiki macho pari, chata chata, gaa pokhari re. Hido khetanka bhitare, thila kantama maa duhinka garbhasaya. Je doudi doudi halya hai surakha pahi, basi jai thanta bhitare. Vivekara tarakon jaluthae, sambidhana prashtare, ना सरकारी ऑफिस रे जेता आलू तम कंपुथिबा देह को झुपुथिबा हजारे काम को तड़ी देबो जो टिकक अधामरा जीवन धरी जन्म नै रहिलो सेति भी तमरा हे पारिलानी ए दुनिया भी तो तमरो न हो भाभी बसिले भी मोर न हो मो शेष को चली चली आसिला बेले देखे विनम्र स्वाभिमान भी रही सोई एका एका तो परिरे लखी एका एका तो परिरे सबिता देई पारिबु कि मते उधार तो मृत्यु टिको लखी देई पारिबु कि मते उधार तो अंध निध सबिता पिपली रे जो गळमाळ ही नतला बबिता तारी आई विल गो ओवर टू इंग्लिश ପିଲାମାନେ ଇଂଲିଶ ବି ଶିଖିବ ଆମ ଭାଷା ନାହିଁ ବୋଲି କ'ଣ ହେଲା ଆରେ ଆମ ଭାଷା ନାହିଁ ବୋଲି ଆମ ଭାଷାରେ ତମାନେ କାହିଁକି ଟପ୍ କରିବନି ଅନ୍ୟ ଦେଶ ଲୋକଙ୍କ ସାଙ୍ଗେ ବି ଶିଖିକରି ସବୁ ଜିନିଷ ଜାଣିବୁ ଏଇଟା ନାହିଁ ଏ ଓଡ଼ିଆ ଇଂଲିଶ ଆମେ ପଢ଼ିବୁନି ଆମ ଭାଷା ନାହିଁ ମୁଁ ସେସବୁରେ ବିଶ୍ୱାସ କରେନି କାହିଁକି ପଢ଼ିବ ଏ ମୁଁ ତ ପୁଣି କଲି କିଛି କଟକରେ ରହିକିରି ହସ୍ତାଲ ଜାଗାରେ ମୁଁ କ'ଣ ବମ୍ବେ ଦିଲ୍ଲୀ କଲିକତାରେ ଥିଲି ଇଏ ତ ଜାଣିବା କଥା କୌଣସି ଜିନିଷ ତମ ପାଇଁ ଅସାଧ୍ୟ ନୁହେଁ ନଥିଙ୍ଗ ଇଜ୍ ଇମ୍ପସିବଲ୍ ଆଣ୍ଡ ଦେର୍ ଆର୍ ନୋ ଲିମିଟ୍ସ ଇନ୍ ଲାଇଫ୍ ୟୁ ହାଭ୍ ଟୁ କ୍ରସ୍ ଅଲ୍ ବାଉଣ୍ଡରିଜ୍ ଦେର୍ ଆର୍ ଓନ୍ଲି ପସିବିଲିଟିଜ୍ ଇନ୍ ଲାଇଫ୍ ଦେର୍ ଆର୍ ନୋ ଲିମିଟ୍ସ ଇନ୍ ଲାଇଫ୍ ପସିବିଲିଟି ଅଛି ଏଇଟା କରିପାରିବ କରିପାରିଲେ ଭାବିଲେ କରିପାରିବ ମୁଁ ପିଲାଙ୍କୁ କହୁଛି ଆପଣମାନଙ୍କୁ କହୁଛି ଦ ଟାଇଟଲ୍ ଅଫ୍ ଦିସ୍ ପୋଏମ୍ ଇଜ୍ ଅନ୍ଇଭନ୍ ମର୍ସିଜ୍ ଆଇ ଆମ୍ ଆଫ୍ରେଡ୍ ଦିସ୍ ଇଜ୍ ମାଇ ଲ୍ୟାଣ୍ଡ ଆଇ ଆମ୍ ଆଫ୍ରେଡ୍ ଦିସ୍ ଇଜ୍ ମାଇ ଲ୍ୟାଣ୍ଡ ହିୟର୍ ଦ ହାଫ୍ ଷ୍ଟାର୍ଭଡ୍ ମଙ୍ଗ୍ରେଲ୍ସ which bark fretfully at the gate are not mine. Yet they are in a way mine, ordering my life. The shadows across my body live out here. They grow old and become parents and ancestors. I'm afraid this is my land. History here puts out its old, wrinkled hands. But I don't know if I could hold them, whether history was friend or enemy anymore. This childish scrap of rock is more than 2,000 years old. But I can never understand its future. Its face frayed from the hushed laughter of years. It still says what it said then. I'm afraid this is my land. Why do you suppose I live in this empty place where the blood of the unjustly killed never cries out, flowing noiselessly out of the earth? Like history, incurable migraine, but unavoidable to see its famous face, looks so vulnerable, looks so empty. I'm afraid this is my land. Perhaps I'm unkind to be calling, to be talking like this. But here, the closed door of ritual never opens. Although out in the tired fields where paddies ripen, about the time the migrating monarchs, butterflies, hover in the trees as they fly down south. And my beautiful grandmother holds her head between her knees as she weeps in the shadow of her death. There is only the world's hatred for her to hide it under her threadbare blanket. It is a dream that begs for night, where she gave up her daughters to rape. The dream that lost count of the times she coaxed it to speak, but the truth would not. I'm afraid this is my land. Here my heart is frightened of poems that dispense heroism to my mothers whose infants are killed before they are born, of lips that smile when they dispense those long screams to the heart that feeds them its body. I'm frightened of religion that is so diseased it has lost its power to think and goes on crushing the poor and the anguished. I'm afraid this is my land. With little to believe in, we believe in the blue that points out of the sky to celebrate the insistence with which man easily turns into a god as he burns alive a missionary and his two sons to teach them a lesson because they professed another faith. I'm afraid this is my land still. Somewhere in the words of this poem, I'm defeated by the blood that tightens my heart, by my thousand thoughts that fail to fall asleep over that silent place where terror and peace meet. Today I find myself lying about my life when I walk into a room full of people obsessed with religion and power and find only our shadows history has left behind. I walk aimlessly as the wind whips up over the river, and I feel the pleasures of men, men who write the story of India with the feet of our epics smeared with blood. Actually, this is an Odia poem, but I have translated it into English. I don't have the Odia version. Slashed with blood-red light, Ashoka turns away from himself, proclaiming, "All men are my children." The silk throats of the waters of Daya, choked with fear and pain, long to speak. The hawk of lightness in the sky now begins the long circling round. The day of days shows its raw power. Ashoka had not thought that heaven would be something to leave him afloat on a flood of unfathomable silence as both life and death stalked his smile. Beyond, the river struggled on with the bamboos drowning their long hair and with the lotuses of grief floating in their sleep. How had he deserved this beauty, this path leading backward through conquests that returned their long night pale? Peace carries too much weight to be carried aloud. Its mask always terrible to look at. And when the old moon rose once more on the devouring evening of victory, to laughter and to revelry. Its meager light seemed to gild the wounded faces of those women picking leftovers of their fallen men in the tortured valley of the Daya. The sky had not blinded Ashoka still, and the stars trembling with blood. Karubaki, Kalinga's vanquished princess, was worth more than 100,000 dead. In his heart, the light of victory leapt. Meaning had not returned to history yet. Language takes a long time to come out of images, the edicts of hollow phrases. And the angels had already been called down. There was no earth he'd seen that was like the one he stood on now. The wounds had closed soon, full of the breath of the world to fill the infinite, a sun's vast light. Elsewhere, the dawn wept to mist. The grasses were sweet and green under the triumphant arches of Magadha. There will always be two worlds, Ashoka thought. What he saw now and what he feared to see. He was disturbed by a sound, a murmur of an exhausted footfall far away, or of broken sobs, longing to plunge into swords and be silenced.
ପିଲାମାନେ ତମେ ଜାଣି ନା 1960-70 ଭିତରେ ବହୁତ ହିପି ଆମର ଏଠିକୁ ଆସୁଥିଲେ ବାହାରୁ ବାହାରୁ ହିପି ମାନେ କ'ଣ ଜାଣିଛ ନାଇଁ ବାହାରର ସବୁ ୟୁରୋପୀୟ ଆମେରିକୀୟ ପୁଅ ଝିଅମାନେ ପୁରୁଷ ସ୍ତ୍ରୀ ଲୋକମାନେ ଆସି ବୁଲାବୁଲି କରି ଏମିତି ଆସି ବୁଲାବୁଲି କରି ଏଠି ଆମ ଦେଶରେ ଟିକେ ବୁଲାବୁଲି କରି ଏଇଠି ଆମ ଆମ କ'ଣ ଆମ ଭିତରେ ରହିବାକୁ ମାନେ ଇଚ୍ଛା କରୁଥିଲେ କିନ୍ତୁ ବୋଧେ ରହି ତାଙ୍କୁ ଭଲ ଲାଗିଲାନି ପଳେଇଲେ ଆଉ ଆସିଲେନି ଦେଇକିରି ସେମାନେ ହିପି ଏଠି ଆସିକିରି ହିପି ସଂସ୍କୃତି ଗୋଟେ ମଝିରେ ହେଇଯାଇଥିଲା ଆଣ୍ଡ କଟକରେ ବି ବୁଲୁଥିଲେ ପୁରୀରେ କଟକରେ ଚାରିଆଡ଼େ ଆଉ ତାରି ଉପରେ ମୁଁ ଗୋଟେ କବିତା ଲେଖିଲି ସେ ବୁଲାବୁଲି କରିଥିଲେ ତ କବିତାର ନାଁ ହେଲା ଦ ଲାଷ୍ଟ ଚିଲଡ୍ରେନ୍ ଅଫ୍ ଆମେରିକା ଆମେରିକାରୁ ଆସି ବୁଲୁଥାନ୍ତି ଦ ଲାଷ୍ଟ ଚିଲଡ୍ରେନ୍ ଅଫ୍ ଆମେରିକା ଇନ୍ ଦ ଡଷ୍ଟି ମାଲେରିଆ ଲେନ୍ସ ଅଫ୍ କଟକ ହୁଅର୍ ୟୁଥ୍ ହାଭ୍ ଲାଷ୍ଟ ଦେୟାର୍ ସିକ୍ରେଟ୍ସ ଦେ ୱଣ୍ଡର୍ These people, they wander. In these lanes nicked by intrigue and rain and the unseen hands of gods. In front of a garish temple of Hanuman, along river banks splattered with excreta and dung. In the crowded market square, among rotting tomatoes, fish scales and the moist, warm odor of bananas and piss. Passing by the big-breasted, hard-eyed young whores who frequent the empty space behind the local cinema, by the town hall where corrupt politicians still go on delivering their pre-election speeches. And on the high road above the town's burning ground from which gluttonous tan smoke floats up in the breeze, smacking of scorched marrow and of doubt. Here, like the unreal stirrings of incense smoke in a darkened shrine, like the languid movements of mangled lepers around the temple of the goddess Chandi at dawn, like a wounded whale drifting away sadly in unknown seas, like the dark winds of Asia, which murmur joylessly in our slums but do not answer. They wander, these lost children of America, flaunting their long, unkempt hair and their bare feet, a man naked to the waist, the fringes of his torn shorts to weary, chapped mouths. A woman, her face of old porcelain, burnt in the harsh sun, clothed indifferently in a discolored sack, her breasts weak and sagging, having lost their glimmer and their power. These lost children wander bare-eyed, smelling of incense and living on grass and flowers, like scavengers accompanied by their impassive shadows, perhaps in search of many gods to ask for strength, with their appearance of sibyls and witches, limp and cold with the ablutions of another separate world. Or perhaps, like she-jackals pursued by invisible hunters who retreat with their wounded cubs into jungle depths, and prompted by something stronger than fear, seek refuge in some forester's shack for succor and for that fierce bond of air, or to find whether these tropic winds would catch and belly out the sails of their minds that have been woven with the strands of sardonic guts. No one knows them. They are the free, the common men, soft and green of gesture, preoccupied with the hidden songs of mankind, mind blown by acid and amphetamines, and we watch them go by with vague feelings of exaltation and disquiet. They are the people we do not need to know. They, for instance, do not travel as guests of Rotary International or the UNO. They are the lost children who rejected their own land and their bejeweled days, who do not need to ask us those oft-repeated questions. Why is my skin so brown? My birth not final? Why do I clean my arse with my hand? Why do I seek a virgin woman for a wife? Why do I grovel before that grotesque god of bitter wood I have helped to carve? And why do I seize wisdom from the saddled sod? I have no need to ask why they come 10,000 miles. For though their eyes are open, they appear asleep. Perhaps too, they are men with dreams, these men rushing through endless supermarket aisles. The calligraphy of hallucinogens in their blue eyes. The incredible flesh in whose innocence they hide. Their breathless thighs, the motor of the precious pubis. Harmless obsessions that take them only for a ride. And in desperate sleep, they move their eyes, opening their hidden faces like lonely postcards of unknown lands. Perhaps some sing, and some others chant the mantras of the dead with that benign resignation of all children, or perhaps like victims waiting out the relentlessness of time, keep watching the skies with terror in their gaze. For at the edge of the dusk, blurred by the glare of unearthly flares, feebled by a sticky silence of faraway flutes, they learn to come to themselves at the threshold of the void, as the emptiness of the sky's luminous bowl fills their eyes with a single hue, the color of the third eye, the oblique, the great, the color of eyes when the light goes out of them, the color of nakedness and of flayed skin, and they recognize states of humiliation and hunger and the well-being of a woman drying herself with her only wet sari after her bath, and the nameless solitude that has nothing to hide behind, no tragedies, small or big, and they find the secret of dying without realizing that they are dying. We gaze at each other in silence. The lost child and I. Who knows who is playing a joke on whom? What can drive me from these mean, sordid alleys where I live? Who is the one among us misled by vision? More real than real, that has filled homes with tremulous ash and has brought from hunger unassuaged the haunted wood and the hunted myth. In the Hanuman temple last night, the priest's pomaded, jean-clad son raped the squint-eyed 14-year-old fisher girl on the cracked stone platform behind the shrine. And this morning, her father found her at the police station, assaulted over and over again by four policemen, dripping of darkness and of scarlet death. In this time of darknesses, the lost ones and I will dim like lamps and go back to the moments we caught once in the uncertain light of dawns, to balance ourselves with falsehood in the color of dead leaves on the earth, falling upon the unreal world of simile and metaphor, glorifying in hyperbole as we wait to be allowed a manner of quieter joy, and silencing the world with borrowed voices of the dead that sing homage to clay in crippling ennui, echoes of an isolating idolatry. And now we will endure the pain when the words of our songs droop like lilies in the dark without standing in judgment. Passing by the abandoned cocoon through the stench of blood over the pure dawn wall, across the stinging smoke of burnt out doubts, perhaps like old men in their bitter lemon gaze who look up wearily from their doorsteps when the light of day is leveling. And so to find the time among us here on earth when history does not reverberate anymore with the pulse of the drum or with the chant of the tide on a sacred Puri shore, but with the echoes of a bruised presence lying like a stone at the bottom of the soul's clear pool, feeling the virtue that is there in the refracted light, the earth sense of what pleases us and of what is lost forever beyond us, as the burden of ununderstood things billows upward like smoke. Thank you.
So it's a real privilege and honor to be reading with Jayantada, of course. It's obvious. So I'll read a few poems, and then I think I'll ask him. We can have a question and answers. I'm sure you all have questions to ask Jayantada. I have lots to ask, and me. And after that, Jayantada will have the final word, and he'll read a poem and close the conference. So this is a poem called Kargil. You know Kargil, children? You know the history of Kargil? About 15 odd years ago, the last war between India and Pakistan, the flashpoint was Kargil. And this is a place I went to. I do a lot of walking and trekking, and I love going to the area of Ladakh. I've spent 3-4 months in the monastery translating the Tibetan prayer, lived in the monastery. But Kargil, so we drove up from Delhi all the way up to Srinagar, across from Leh, Srinagar to Leh, and then came back down from what is this called, the other side, the loop. And my young son at that time said, Baba, we have to go to Kargil. Why? If it was not on my map. Because he was at an age where he was playing with plastic guns and so on. So he had this sort of notion about heroism, misplaced heroism. Of course, I took him to Kargil, and it's a normal outpost of a town, completely normal. And at least for us poets, it's worth going anywhere because something or the other happens. It opens with an epigraph from Derek Walcott.
Cope's poem called Teopolo's Hound. Cargill. Our street of smoke and fences, gutters gorged with weed and reeking, scorching iron grooves of rusted galvanize, a dialect forged from burning asphalt, and a sky that moves with thunderhead cumuli, grumbling with rain. 10 years on, I came searching for war signs of the past, expecting remnants, magazine debris, unexploded shells, shrapnels that mark bomb wounds. I came looking for ghosts, people past, skeletons charred, abandoned brick wood cement that once housed them. I could only find whispers, whispers among the clamor of a small town outpost in full throttle, everyday chores catching outward signs of normalcy and life. In that bustle, I spot war lines of a decade ago, though the storylines are kept buried, wrapped in old newsprint. There's order amid uneasiness, the muezzins cry, the monks chant, baritones merging in their separateness. At the bus station, black coughs of exhaust smokescreen everything. The roads meet and after the crossroad ritual diverge, skating along the undotted lines of control. A porous garland with cracked beads adorns Tiger Hill. Beyond the mountains are dark memories, and beyond them no one knows, and beyond them no one wants to know. Even the flight of birds that wing over their crests don't know which feathers to down. Chameleon-like, they fly, tracing perfect parabolas. I look up and calculate their exact arc and find instead a flawed theorem. I grew up, when I was a child, I used to come to my grandfather's house, grandparents' house in Bankura in West Bengal, and usually would spend about 2 months there. And they had this beautiful, large banyan tree, not very unlike the one you have in the Konark temple complex. So this is a poem called Banyan. In Delhi, of course, one has a very small place. So I planted a tulsi plant and told myself that's the banyan tree of my past, of my lineage. So I said, you know, there has to be a banyan tree in my life, and this is the banyan tree which is in Delhi, but it actually is a tulsi plant, but it's talking about the banyan tree back in the hometown. And I'll just see, you'll just see what happens. Banyan. As winter secrets melt with the purple sun, what is revealed is electric. Notes tune unknown scales, syntax alters tongues, terracotta melts white, banyan ribbons into armatures as branch roots twist, meeting soil in a circle. Circuits glazed under cloth carry alphabets for a calligrapher's nib, italicized in invisible ink, letters never posted, cartographer's map uncharted, as phrases fold, so do veils. And I translate from Bangla, Hindi, and Urdu. I have three mother tongues, Bengali, Hindi, and Urdu, English, Bengali, and Bangla, but I read Urdu in the Devanagari script. Not anymore. I've forgotten Gujarati. There's this famous poem, as you grow up as a Bengali in a house, you know, we have a real problem, and I'm saying it in a bit of a tongue-in-cheek way. Tagore is coming out of every orifice, to the point that as a youngster, I started disliking Tagore because there was so much of Tagore around me. The poets I used to admire are people like Jivananda Dash, Qazi Nazrul Islam, Faiz Ahmed Faiz, Ghalib. Those are the ones that actually really turned me on at the time. Of course, as an adult, I have a very different view of Tagore. I do like him. I've translated him and so on. But when something is forced at you, you know, as a youngster, you tend to rebel. Well, this is the most important. This is a very, very famous poem by Jivananda Das. Of course, it's Bonalata Sen. Everybody knows Bonalata Sen. It's one of the most translated poems in the world. But my problem is whenever I've read, seen the translations, they don't have the rosh, you know, the maza of the Bengali rhythm, the pulse. So what I did was I first read out the Bangla to myself and took the notation of the entire line, the beats, the scansion, and the rhyme scheme. And then I had this grid without any words in it. And I said, I'm going to translate exactly with the chondo and the cadence and the register. So this is my version of Banulata Sen by Jivananda Das. For a thousand years I walked this earth's passage by day and night. From Lanka's shores to Malay's vast seas, I've traveled much, been a guest at Bimbisar and at Ashok's courts, stayed in the distant nights in the town of Bidharbo. I'm long worn out. Around me, waters of sea and life have endlessly swirled. My only peace, a fleeting moment snatched with her. Naturer Bonalata Sen. Chultar Khobekar Andhokar Bidishar Nisha. Like the dense ink night of Bidisha, her hair black, deep black. Her face like the delicate weave of Shrabosti's filigree frieze. Just as a lost boatman, rudderless, tossing in the far seas, chances upon a lush green isle of spice, I too caught a sight, saw her, a mere glimpse in the dark. Gently raising her eyes like a bird's nest, she whispered, "Where were you all this while?" And there she stands at my dream's end, my own Bonalata Sen. With soft settling hiss of dew, evening closes the day's end. Kites erase from their wings sun-stained smell of flight. When colors of the earth gently fade, fireflies light up their palette, and old songs find new lyric, old stories new score. Birds return home, so do the rivers, as life strayed, its give and take ceases. Only the dark stays, and just as it remains, so does, sitting by my side, face to face, my own Bonalata Sen. I'll just end with the poem, which is, both these books are available. This is literally 2 days old, my new book. And this is a book of Goddo Kobita, prose poetry. I'll just read one poem. In fact, I wrote this in Orissa, as it turns out. I've come to Orissa many, many times for various reasons over the years, at least 20 or 25 times. This is probably nearly my 30th trip. So this is a poem I wrote I was very, very hot in this room I was staying. There was a power cut, as is usual. And I went to the terrace because that was the coolest place in the house. Tried to sleep, couldn't. And suddenly the clouds opened. And it was a beautiful, beautiful moment. Getting wet at the night and in an Orion rain in Phil Fury is just particularly special. So that's what happened. And this is what happened. Me. It's called Night Rain. I woke up 3 a.m. with a start. I was shivering and sweating profusely at the same time. The cotton t-shirt I had on was completely drenched. So was the bedsheet I was lying on. Outside, I could hear the rain hitting the terrace floor with relentless ferocity. Thunderclaps shook the glass panes to near breaking point. I love the sound of water and rain, whatever their mood. It has a certain sense of assurance, a steadiness that isn't present in other elements. I had a spontaneous desire to step out into the rain. I was drenched anyway, so feeling the rain on my back would do me no harm. Besides, getting wet in the night rain has its own peculiar thrills. I stepped out. My body heat met this rain. Rainwater sizzled off my skin, steaming up in curls of white vapor. All I could see and imagine was a blanket of hoarfrost that enveloped me and the rain. Night rain camouflaged in the steam of body heat. Thank you.
Ascharya kala bhali nua ba bhinna tathya ama samna ko ani dei pare sati ki kar dei pare au kabira abhilash कवि को तो निज आत्मार गभीरता को ठेली दिए जहाँ चिंताधारा को उद्दीपित करे कवितार शब्द नुआ जीवन धरी शक्तिशाली हमारी आज निज को मु पचार पचमता दिए ना कहीं कष्ट कली अधराति भोर भोर रे कविता लिखी बसुचे मु जानकारी से कविता गोटे न हो पारे କିନ୍ତୁ ମୋ ପାଖେ ତ ଆଉ କିଛି ନାହିଁ କେବଳ ଲାଳସାଟି ମୋର ମୋତେ ଚୁପ୍ ହେଇ ବସିବାକୁ ଦିଏ ନାହିଁ ଏଇ ଲାଳସାଟି କକ ଏଇ ଲାଳସାରୁ ହୁଏତ କବିତାର ସୃଷ୍ଟି ମୋର ଏକା ନୁହେଁ ଆମ ସମସ୍ତଙ୍କର ଅନେକ ପ୍ରଶ୍ନ ଉଠେ ମନରେ ଜୀବନ ବିଷୟରେ ମୃତ୍ୟୁ ବିଷୟରେ ଆଉ ଏଇସବୁ ରୂପ ଦିଏ କବିତାକୁ କିନ୍ତୁ ଉତ୍ତର ବା କୌଣସି ସିଦ୍ଧାନ୍ତରେ ପହଞ୍ଚି ହୁଏ ନାହିଁ ପୁଣି ସମୟ ଦସ୍ୟୁ ଗୋଟାଏ ପରି ସବୁବେଳେ ପଚେ ପଚେ ଥାଏ କାନ୍ଧରେ ତାହାର ନିଷ୍ଠୁର ହାତ ସମୟର ମୁଁ ତ କେବେ ମୁଁ ଦେଖିନାହିଁ ଖାଲି ଦେଖିଛି ତାର ଉଦାସୀନତା ତାର ମାଧ୍ୟାକର୍ଷଣ ଶକ୍ତି ଅନ୍ୟାୟ ଅମାନୁଷିକତା ଭିତରେ ଘର ଆମର ଦିନ ଦିନର ଗୋଟିଏ ଗୋଟିଏ ଘଟଣା ମନରେ ଘା କରିଦିଏ ହେଇଯାଏ ଏକ ବିରାଟ ଘା ସେ ଘା କେବେ ବି ଶୁଖେ ନାହିଁ ସେଇଥିପାଇଁ ଜଣେ ଲେଖି ବସେ ଆଉ କିଛି କରିପାରେ ନାହିଁ ବୋଲି ରାସ୍ତାରେ ମରୁଥିବା ଲୋକଟିକୁ ଡାକ୍ତରଖାନା ନେବାକୁ ମୋର ସାହସ ହୁଏ ନାହିଁ ଟିବି ହେଇଥିବା ଝିଅକୁ ସାହାଯ୍ୟ କରିବାକୁ ବା କାହାରି ଉପକାର ବି କରିବାକୁ ମୁଁ ଆଗେଇ ଯାଏ ନାହିଁ ନିଷ୍ଫଳ କବିତା ଯେତେ ସେଇ କଲମରୁ ବାହାରେ ଆଉ ମୋର ଇତିହାସକୁ ବି ମୁଁ ଭୁଲିପାରେ ନାହିଁ କେବେ ବି ପ୍ରତ୍ୟେକ ମୁହୂର୍ତ୍ତରେ ମୋତେ ସାବଧାନ କରାଉଥାଏ ସେଇ ଫମ୍ପା ଇତିହାସ ମୋର ପରମ୍ପରା ମୋ ଜେଜେନଙ୍କ ଦୁର୍ଭିକ୍ଷରେ ଯେତେବେଳେ ଭୋକରେ ତେନ୍ତୁଳି ପତ୍ର ଖାଇ ଜୀବନ ବଞ୍ଚାଇଥିଲେ ଜେଜେମାର ମାଆକୁ ଯେତେବେଳେ ମୋର ଭାଲୁ ଖାଇବା କଥା ମୋ ନିଜ କଥା ମୋ ନିଜ ମହାନଦୀ କଥା ଆଉ ମୋର ମନେ ହୁଏ ମୁଁ ବୋଧ ହୁଏ ପ୍ରକୃତିରେ ହିଁ ମୋର ପ୍ରକୃତ ଈଶ୍ୱର ମୁଁ ମୋର ଈଶ୍ୱର ଆଉ କେହି ନୁହେଁ ବୁଝିବାକୁ ମୋତେ କଷ୍ଟ ହୁଏ ପରିତକ୍ତ କୌଣସି ପଡ଼ିଆ ଘାସରେ ମୁକ୍ତ ଆକାଶ ରହିଲେ ଗଡ଼ିଗଲେ କେମିତି ମନରେ ଘା ଗୋଟିଏ ଗୋଟିଏ ଭଲ ହେବା ପରି ଲାଗେ ଯେଉଁ ତୃପ୍ତିଟି ଗୋଟେ କବିତା ଲେଖିଲା ପରି ତ ନଥାଏ ଯେଉଁ ତୃପ୍ତିଟି କବିତା ଲେଖିଲା ପରେ ବି ମୋତେ ଦିଏନି ସେମିତି ଇଚ୍ଛା ହୁଏ ପ୍ରକୃତିକୁ କହିବାକୁ ଆରେ ପ୍ରକୃତି ମୋ ମନକୁ ଯଦି କଲମ କରିପାରନ୍ତି କବିତା ବୋଧେ ବାହାରନ୍ତା ଗୋଟେ ପ୍ରତିଧ୍ୱନି ହେଇ ଧନ୍ୟବାଦ